Hello and welcome to Automotive Logistics and Supply Chain Live. Thank you very much for your patience. Sorry about the technical issues we've been experiencing this morning, but we want to power on with a fantastic, concise and compact session. In this session, we're getting heavy. We're talking heavy trucks and buses, and I'm joined by the two of the sector's heavyweights themselves, Fabio Castello, Senior Vice President of Logistics at Scania, and Peter Hernlein, Head of Logistics at MAN Truck and Bus.
Hello, everybody. Welcome from my side.
Hi, Peter. And great to have you here. And thanks for joining us. So perhaps let's kick off with you and let's get a start as a quick update looking at the wider heavy commercial vehicle sector. How's it currently performing?
So far, it's really mixed vehicles in the market. On the one side, we experience a good order book and the need for heavy trucks, and customers are urgently waiting for them, and we try our utmost to fulfill their needs and produce them as quickly as possible. On the bus side, the picture is a little bit diverse. Say the intercity buses or the city buses, we also see a quite good demand from the market, and the tenders of the municipalities or the cities are going more or less as normal, or even with an increased demand. In the coach business, like the travel buses, the tourism industry, obviously we saw a big decline in spring this year, and that hasn't recovered yet at all.
Yeah, okay, so there's some positive shoots there. Obviously a challenging year, but certainly some challenging times as to be expected. So unlike the passenger vehicle production around the world, the commercial vehicle sector had very little downtime during the peak of the pandemic, where most regions experienced some form of lockdown and restrictions. How did you keep your global supply chains operating during this time?
To be honest, we also had to go in a lockdown from the middle or the end of March towards the end of April. So for 4 weeks, all of our factories have come to a standstill. The reason why we decided for that is we would know that sooner or later one of our critical supply chains would collapse, but we never could say which one at which time and whether it would be a part from Spain or Italy or from the UK or from China or from India. So we said, okay, let's rather go in a controlled lockdown, prepare for a ramp up again. And by the end of April and beginning of May, we then subsequently brought all our plants back online. Of course, with the right protection measures for our associates, of course, with the right concepts to separate walkways, to keep the distancing. We supplied them with protective equipment like mouth masks. We also have medical support there, checking body temperature before they enter the plant and so on. But subsequently, we have ramped up again, and we are now with our production volumes back on a level pre the corona lockdown situation, which is quite good for us. And as I said, we would like to do even more, and we are constantly trying to achieve that.
Yeah, absolutely. And you mentioned bring your plants back online. Was that all at the same time, or was there a sequence to that? And how did you manage that?
We did it in a sequence. We started with the bus plants, especially with our bus plant in Ankara in Turkey and with the bus plant in Poland. And then a week later, we brought the truck plants back online. Of course, our engine plants and our component plants producing and supplying axles and engines, we also had to bring online a little bit beforehand so that they have enough finished goods on stocks and on hand in order to supply the vehicle plants. But that worked in a very smooth way and very successfully.
Yeah, absolutely. And I guess communication must have been key working with your suppliers to enable your supply chain. Maybe a supply chain is only as strong as the weakest link. So how important is greater transparency and how important was that communication with your supply chain?
I'm a strong believer that this was really a key success factor, because as you say, it's as strong as the weakest link. And we found out that now we see weak links in the supply chain, which we never had to worry about at all. For instance, we have now to focus on a supply from tier 3 levels, which has never been an issue or a capacity shortage in the past, but for example, sensors that are used in devices for our trucks, but as well as in devices for the medical industry or in medical products. Now, all of a sudden, they get regulated and the priorities get shifted. So it's very hard to predict what's coming on. But we kept a very open and quick and high frequent communication. Of course, the digital means helped us doing that with daily conferences on the critical suppliers, on the critical supply chains. And every time when we send increased call-offs or increased volumes to the supplier, we also double check with them. Have you really gotten it? Can you really confirm you have the capacity on hand? So that we try to secure the supply chain as much as possible. However, and I really want to thank our suppliers and our logistics service providers and transport companies at that moment also. It's a joint effort, it's a collaboration effort, and it really proved that the parties in the logistics supply chain could really work together when it matters and find quick solutions. And that's something I hope we can carry also that spirit then after the corona phase or the pandemic phase and say, okay, what did we learn out of that experience and what can we transfer to improve our processes and our collaboration in the future as well?
Yeah, absolutely. And I think, you know, although this has been a very trying and challenging period for everyone, yeah, there's been a huge number of lessons that we have learned, and you started to touch on them a bit more. So perhaps we can delve a bit deeper into some of those lessons and how are they going to shape the supply chain that you're leading and creating for the future?
And on the one side, I think we really have in the future to keep an eye on the supplier selection process, and that once we know where the supplier will be located and which component or what nature of component they're going to supply, that we really design and secure the processes upfront. And then, of course, we need to heavily increase all along the supply chain with all parties the means which digitization offers us, in terms of exchanging data quickly, in terms of achieving transparency quickly, and install early warning mechanisms so that you really find out when the problem arises and not when you start to have it, because then it's too late, then you don't have any time to react anymore. But for instance, for overseas shipments, if you get the message, okay, I cannot ship the part out, then you can talk about alternative suppliers, alternative supply chain, try to make things happen. Once you experience in your receiving area, the part that should have arrived by now is now not there, then obviously it's too late and you don't have any room to react. But as I said, the communication worked quite well. The proactive information worked also quite well. And so far we experienced very little supply problems after we ramped up again. And we see now with an increase of the volumes that the supply chains get more tense and that the capacities go up to the limit. But so far, the lockdown phase or the weeks coming out of the lockdown have worked really successfully. And I guess everybody was a bit surprised that it went that well.
Yeah, and interesting to hear, you know, the surprise in the supply chain resilience, but that's strong to see. And you know, you touched upon greater market volatility. I think you mentioned, you know, the coach market's down, for example. When that ramps up, how are you preparing for that quicker reaction time? You know, are you having to be more agile, and how are you doing that?
Of course, we have to be more agile and we have to be more flexible. And one, say, key solution to that is that we really keep a very frequent or a high frequency of communication and information exchange with all of our supply base and our logistics service providers. And that we also quite openly speak about demand and program figures. And say, okay, we are planning for an increase here. Please get prepared. Please get your production also ready for it. And if we see, okay, things do not really turn out as we have predicted it, then we also let them know immediately. So we try to keep that back and forth in a very tense and tight relationship. Because from our point of view, it would not make sense just to start now stocking up parts and goods, because you just create immense pressure on the supply chain right now. And nobody knows exactly whether that immense pressure is needed or whether that work. As I said, on the truck side, we see a rather stable demand and a good order book and demand for our products. On the bus side, it's a lot more volatile. But we have also prepared our factories to be flexible so that the one bus plant can help the other and vice versa if we experience peaks or downturns in capacity of certain products.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think you mentioned there, you mentioned a lot, but you know, something that I wanted to delve a bit deeper in is that support for the supply chain. You said you don't want to put them under unnecessary pressure. Because they're already perhaps at their limits. So it'd be interesting to know how you and your teams are working with the supply chain, with the suppliers to support them. You know, perhaps they're facing liquidity or challenges with their own suppliers in the sub tiers. So how is that looking for you?
Well, of course, if they experience problems in their own supply chain, we try to help as much as possible, even helping with our procurement guys going into alternative sub-suppliers or providing parts from other suppliers where they not have a direct relation with. Also, we try to help them in the field of transport is needed. And also some of our carriers that we used for other suppliers have stepped in and picked up goods from alternative suppliers and brought them in if that was needed. Of course, also from the procurement side, they're dealing with the financial burdens we see in that situation. And of course, there is also some support for supply chains where it becomes critical. But on top of that, I think it's really important to keep the whole thing transparent. And it's also really important to exchange the information in a very quick way. And also, if somebody experiences a problem, as sooner we know, we can also react with our production program or blocking vehicles and producing others instead. And that flexibility, I think, we are using now to a much higher degree than ever before and with all parties involved. And I think that has never been seen beforehand to such a degree. Of course, what we do not want to do is, as I said, we do not want to keep a too high pressure on the supply chain by stocking up, because it would require our suppliers to stock up material as well, which would be also a financial burden for them in terms of cash flow. And for sure, we also have to watch our finances in that situation as well, so that we do not keep unnecessary material and parts on stock, because that's also puts pressure on the financial situation.
Yeah, absolutely. And some fascinating insights there, and a look at how important it is, that transparency across the lower tiers of the supply chain as well. Fabio, welcome, and thanks for joining us.
Thank you.
A little later than planned, but we hope to squeeze a few more minutes with you. So we've covered quite a bit already, but just wanted to get an update from Scania's perspective. How are things looking with you and your supply chain right now?
Yes. Yeah, I would just complement also what Petter said. I think during the crisis, we learned how to be much more agile, and those processes that were made monthly became weekly. Those that were weekly are now done daily. So we learned how to reset the whole production program and the supply chain monitoring and actions to a much, much more agile and dynamic setup. Even though big part of our teams were working from home, so the speed with our organizations adapted to the new setup, to the new conditions is extremely positive. What we see that in the truck industry, the volumes are bouncing back. So we are gearing up to levels pre-crisis. But of course, this has new factors around us, because we have some some proven record of capacity of our supply chain from providers, from suppliers, but now all these actors in the chain are also facing challenges complying with the local distancing regulations and also their sub-suppliers, so second and third tier suppliers. So I mean, that's going to be a quite challenging ramp up. And therefore, the topic that you just mentioned, the transparency and the communication with the suppliers and providers is extremely important. So Scania is opening, is acting with different fronts. We are doing webcasts. We are communicating through our portal. We are sending letters. We are talking by phone and by email with the most critical suppliers, just to make sure that we understand the temperature in the supply chain, and we can act quickly and going through this unknown territory that we are right now.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think that that support there is key for this this transformation and this this period of time. And hopefully is a model that stays with the supply chain. From the conversations throughout this conference, we've heard that people adopting this change and making these changes want that to continue as something that's positive to come out of this. Let's shift the conversation a little bit to electrification, a big part of the transformation of the automotive industry. Some exciting news this week. I saw Scania launching its fully electric truck with a 250-kilometer range. So you're already there in terms of electrification, but how has that impacted your supply chains, creating new supply chains and impacting the models and processes that you've got in place?
Yep. A good question, Richard. And I would say that for us, for logistics and procurement, we are just adding more complexity to our assortment, new components that have different conditions to be stored, to be transported, the safety concerns and handling requirements are different. But we are learning what are those new requirements and just bringing new suppliers to our network. So I wouldn't say that the electrification for the supply chain is a big transformation. The biggest transformation is, of course, on the product side, how the products are used, and of course, all the environmental benefits of these new solutions. So we are learning. We are just building our new battery factory here in Södertälje. So logistics is an active part of this transformation, contributing with ideas how to make these flows more efficient. So I see that from that perspective, it's a new field. Okay, it's more parts coming. What can we do based on the learnings we have had in the last years, as we're starting from scratch, how we can do even better?
Yeah, absolutely. And we started to touch upon it there, but I think something our audience are always keen to hear is what do you look for in terms of your providers and suppliers, and when you're looking to cement existing relationships or create new ones and new partnerships, whether it be for electrification and or for the through the existing models, and same to you, Peter, as well, to bring you back into the conversation.
If I can answer first, and I think Peter and I we talk almost weekly, and we are very much aligned in most of these aspects. I see that going forward, as we just mentioned about transparency, so the importance for the chain to understand what is happening in our connections, it's becoming very, very, very critical to everybody. So those that will be part of our chain, those that are in the chain today and want to be part of our chains in the future, we have to focus on transparency. So to really understand what is happening, to be digitalized, so we can optimize how the communication and how the process, the logistics and information process are optimized, and sustainability, especially when it comes to Scania way of handling the future RFQs. We have a balance. In one side is efficiency. So of course, we want to partner with those companies that can provide world-class solutions to us. We have cost in another edge. On the top edge, we have sustainability. So all our new RFQs are also considering what's the CO2 impact in our businesses. So it's a balance of these three edges. It's a triangle for us.
Yeah, absolutely. And maybe, Peter, I can ask you to comment on this, something that's cropped up in some questions from the other audience participation is questions around sustainability. Often greener solutions aren't necessarily the cheapest. So how are you managing that or balancing that in terms of the partners you're selecting and working with as sustainability becomes ever increasingly important?
To add on what Fabio just mentioned, we are looking at all of the aspects, efficiency, cost, and sustainability, and we really try to achieve the optimum process or the corporate optimum coming out of the three. And for sure, there are also targets with regards to CO2 emissions, and we also have to bring our contribution to achieve them. And yes, sometimes that comes at a higher cost. But on the other side, especially for the commercial vehicle industry, there is also a regulation that would set penalties if you do not achieve and adhere to the CO2 targets. So then the business case calculation becomes a little bit of a different one. How much do I spend right now in order to avoid a bigger penalty in the future? And I think we have to take some investment. And what Fabio mentioned, we are always in close contact, and we are also together exploring new fields. For instance, we have also investigated how would it look like if we would do our finished vehicle logistics for the truck business on train instead of road traffic. And I think that was a quite successful pilot that we did there. And the experience we gained out of it helps, of course, now going for future tenders and designing future outbound supply chains, for example.
Yeah, great. Very, very interesting. Thank you. And useful for our audience to hear that. I think we're close to wrapping up here. So I just want to close by kind of ending on a positive note. It's been a challenging year, but you know, what's exciting you both right now in the supply chain or world of automotive supply chain and logistics? Fabio, I'll put you on the spot first.
Yeah, thank you. The excitement is that to go back to those levels that our industry has invested for. So to see that that pessimism or the thunder scenarios that we evaluated are going more towards cloud and sun scenarios. So especially in the truck, that's not the same for buses, but when it comes to for trucks, the orders are coming. So there is a lot of expectations. It's still uncertainty, but it's very good to work towards a future where we see where volumes and the utilization of our installed capacity are more normal, if we can say so. And doing that with all the learnings we had from the crisis, from the working virtually to communicate in a more efficient way, the digitalization journey. So that's what's giving me excitement every day to come to work.
Fantastic. And Peter, from your side?
For MAN, I think 2020 has been a very exciting year, besides what we talked mainly about with the corona lockdown and the challenges for the supply chains related to that. Foremost, we have in February launched our new truck generation, which is a great product and which was a very successful launch. So that meant for us a lot in MAN to bring that new product on the road. And now having that excitement of supplying the new truck, getting the launch successfully accomplished, delivering it to our customers, And on top of that, facing the challenges that are related to the Corona situation or the COVID-19 situation that impacted the supply chain. So I think these two in combination make it a very special year. The positive note from my side is I think we accomplished things that nobody thought were possible in the past. And I also think that we were able to adapt to that situation fairly quickly, learn a lot of it, make the right decisions, and then successfully manage it. And with that learning aspect, that gives me a lot of optimism for the future. If we can cover a year like that, then I think a lot has to come for everybody being in the field of supply chain management and logistics to make them really nervous in the future then.
Yeah, fantastic. Well, I think those two points that you make, you know, a very positive way to end, and there should be optimism ahead, and it's an exciting future for supply chain. So thank you both of you so much for joining us, and thank you for our audience, the patience. I think it was certainly worth waiting for, and stick around, because coming up next, we've got a next session just a few moments away. We'll be looking at logistics automation with Ford and Macro Plastics giving their insights. So plenty still to come. Thanks again, and Rich Logan signing off.